Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another nerdy episode of Another Nerdy Talk Show. So, we got a lot of stuff tonight there. I hope you enjoyed that little trailer. We'll get into it a little bit later. But yes, we are going to have him next week. So, let's get into this. Tonight! I really got to be prepared for this stuff. I mean, seriously, like, look at this shit. I mean, like, I got to... Is it the snap? Is it the snap? Do I got to get the Infinity Gauntlet? Come on. Ow. So, tonight... We have trailers for Ghostbusters, Shang-Chi and the Ten Rings. Quite frankly, we're getting a lot of Comic-Con's leftovers. Or whatever. It's hard to say that. Anyway, aside from that, a little bit of other news there. After 25 years, a beloved children's cartoon is coming to an end. Arthur is ending public broadcast on PBS this year. Next year. Is it a Wonderful Kind of Day? I can't tell. I'm not doing this just for the memes. I'm just saying that, you know. Anyway, what else do we got here? Oh, yes, here we go. It is time for a regeneration as Jodie Whittaker announces that she will be leaving the series Doctor Who, along with its showrunner, Chris Chibnall? I apologize if I'm saying that wrong. Chris Chibnall? Who's going to be next? Well, there's some ideas, but we'll be getting to that later tonight. Netflix announces a new Pokemon live-action series. A brand new series that's coming out here. And after the success that was Detective Pikachu, the possibilities are 50-50 maybe? Oh yeah, on a side note, Pokemon Snap just announced some new DLC for the game. And all of it is free. What do you got in here? Are there any original ideas? I'm just going to say yes, there are some cool original stuff in here. And that's the kind of thing to bring up here because, like, it does play a big, important role. Speaking of Netflix, we got the release dates of the upcoming My Little Pony, the new generation series, or Gen 5, I don't know. I'm calling it My Little Pony Gen 5. I don't really care, honestly. But, like, we got news on that. There's really not a lot on it, but, like, I went on Equestria Daily. They didn't really post the date, so I had to look it up. Thanks a lot! Anyway, what else we got here? And lastly, we got not only a premiere date, but also a tweet that is... for the upcoming Marvel series, Hawkeye. Wrong one. Hawkeye. There we go. So, yeah. We got a tweet. We got a screenshot. It's looking really good. I can't wait to show it to you all. All that and more on what should have been shown at Comic-Con on tonight's episode of Ants. We will be right back.
You're watching Another Nerdy Talk Show. Remember to brush your fucking teeth.
And now, some imperative advice to get you through the week. Hopefully.
Hello, and welcome to the show. Here's your imperative Sunday. Live as cheaply as one, as long. Nice thing about egotists, they don't talk about other people. Show me a guy with his feet firmly on the ground, and I'll show you a guy who can't take his pants off. Thank you for watching Imperative Advice. And now, back to Ants.
This has been your Imperative Advice to get you through the week.
Warning, please use this imperative advice at your own risk. Shaded Sex Studios is not responsible if this imperative advice gets you sent to the hospital, arrested, bullied, thrown off a train, mauled by monkeys, or anything else that is too gruesome to think of. Side effects of following this imperative advice may include rashes, burning, overabundance of laughter, random need to toe-tap, everlasting pain, death, being barred from your favorite clubs, and possible chance of turning into a lemming. Do not follow this imperative advice if you are prone to breathing, moving, making noises, or pretty much anything that makes you a regular human being. Bottom line, what we are essentially saying is, DON'T BE A MORON!
You're watching Another Nerdy Talk Show. Roses are red, violets are blue, we hope you're still watching. And if you're not, then fuck you.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to another Nerdy Talk Show, where we're just sitting here chill with my usual friends here, Bright Idea and Kuma the Sleepy. We're gonna be talking about a lot of cool stuff tonight. Good stuff, bad stuff, stuff that climbs on rocks. I can't remember the rest of the jingle. But like
stuff that climbs on rocks?
It's that one hot dog commercial.
I don't know.
Tough kids, showy kids, kids that climb on rocks.
Oh dang, I think I know what you're talking about.
Yeah. I forgot what the name of the hot dog brand was. Anyway, so we got that going on tonight. So how are you guys doing tonight? You doing fine? Apparently,
yeah.
Derpy's best pony. Apparently, Derpy's best pony hopes he doesn't have Wi-Fi problems this time.
Mm.
I hope he doesn't because my God, I can't wait to talk to people.
Oh, what is up, YouTube? How's your week been?
I work at Disney. At summertime.
Oh, isn't that fun?
Berries. I mean, like, honestly, a little bit here at Monsters, Inc. is going to be opening soon, so I'm really excited to work back at Monstropolis.
Mm. It's only to catch Monsters at Work that's on Disney Plus.
I haven't heard much of it, honestly.
Yeah.
Yeah, same thing. I've heard about that, but I haven't really, like, heard anything actually about it.
Yeah, I mean, I've heard from one of the YouTubers I watched that it takes place in the day after they discover that the factory can run on laughs instead of screams.
Yeah.
And so you have a monster graduating from the university,
okay.
and his first day at work is like, okay, I'm ready to scare kids. It's like, nope, we're making them laugh now.
Not you're frozen again. But yeah, like, Kuma, here's the deal, the premise. Okay, so there are these monsters, and they're at work.
Yes, I've seen the movie.
There you go, Monsters at Work. I saw Monsters University. I did see Monsters University, but I only remember two scenes from it. It's the scene where they're breaking into Monsters, Inc. And the mom tells him she's going to listen to her tunes, and the moment they goes out, she, like, turns it on, like, Mastodon blasts off.
Yeah. Just that heavy hardcore. I really was not expecting that either. Like, honestly, and all, like, just, I was expecting maybe like something horrific, maybe, but like nothing like just straight up like metal.
But like, the funny thing is, like, me and my sister saw it in the theater, and the only
Monsters Inc.
Monsters University. And the only other scene that made us laugh our asses off for some reason was when they get caught, and the first thing the one monster shouts is, "I can't go back to jail!" And that just had us laughing for a solid 5 minutes. We don't know why.
Yeah.
I'm not gonna lie, I actually did really like the principal in there, or the headmaster, or whatever.
Her character design is phenomenal.
Oh, yeah,
like, why is she a teacher? She should have been one of the top scarers. Like, she should have been in the first movie. Like
yeah,
that's who you have to beat. That's the legend right there.
Maybe monster sexism? I don't know.
No, well, it was monster sexism. They wouldn't. Actually, yeah, you don't see a lot of. I don't know if they're wearing.
Wait, where are the female scarers?
Wait, yeah, what? Whoa, I don't remember. Any...
I mean, you got Celia. She's a receptionist.
Yeah.
And you got.
And Buzz. She's the.
Well,
she's the head of.
She's the head of the. That cleaning crew, whatever they are,
the CDA,
yeah.
CDA,
yeah,
but they're not,
yeah,
they're not the child, and... they're not the child protection agency anymore. They're the comedy protection, detection agency now.
Wow, that's like I feel like it's like that's like the pun police or something.
And Roz, Roz is probably the most she's probably the most impersonated character at the attraction. It's really funny.
Yeah.
There needs to be a video camera in the shape of Roz that just like watches everybody, and under it says always watching.
I'm watching.
That was
funny.
When we were brought back, we actually did get to tour the Monsters Inc. laugh floor. They did have it prepared for quarantine stuff at the time, but I remember when we got in there, the Roz screen was still on, and I remember even in quarantine, she's always watching.
Really?
But so good to be back at Monstropolis. I really am looking forward to hearing seeing Besnos Boyle do his mime reading act, Buddy Boyle tell jokes and hit with hypnotism. Sam and Ella, can't wait to see you again. Mac and Jeeves as well. Can't wait for the geography lesson. Mm-hmm. And of course, Little Marty. Little Marty, I can't wait to hear you read the jokes that people send you. August 8th, ladies and gentlemen. August 8th. So, let's talk about our trailers tonight. We got two trailers today that honestly should have been at Comic-Con last week.
Actually, say the name of the Marvel movie, of the Marvel trailer that you just said, because I swear to God, I wanted to interrupt you so much when you said the name.
Shang-Chi.
Oh my God, no. That is not how you say it.
It is Shang-Chi. Is it Shang-Chi? It's the guy. I'm saying that because the guy on the trailer says Shang-Chi.
Yeah, that's how they would say it, but the actual character's name is Shang-Chi.
Like, I don't know, like, is it, how would it be said in Chinese? Japanese? Is he Chinese or Japanese?
I think specifically he might be more Chinese.
How would it be said in China? Like, Shang-Chi?
I think so.
Anyway, let's talk about Ghostbusters.
I'm just going off of the mini comics that I've seen people talk about.
Let's talk about Ghostbusters. Ghostbusters Afterlife. The first trailer we got for this movie was way before the world got on fire.
Mm-hmm.
And it was kind of like oblivious, honestly. Like, when I saw it, I thought, honestly, I forgot this movie was even coming out.
Yeah, same.
I totally forgot about it, too. Like, just seeing it on Facebook and everything like that, just scrolling through, I was just like, "What? Wait, we're getting another Ghostbusters movie?"
Yeah.
And you're like, oh, yeah. So what we're getting at here is, I couldn't really tell on the premise, honestly. Like, these guys are going from I think one of the children of the original Ghostbusters, I believe Egon's. I'm not gonna...
Yeah.
Because he said
I want to say so, yeah.
Because he said Egon had this place here for something, so yeah. May he rest in peace, Harold Ramis. But The whole thing was, like, they go to this farmhouse and he finds the Ghostbuster mobile, or whatever it's, Ecto-1, yeah. Excuse me, Ecto-1. And he unlocks it, and then shit starts to get real. They open a well and hell breaks out. And yeah, we get to see a lot of throwbacks. Stay Puft Marshmallow Man have turned into toys.
Yeah.
What else are they?
They could be Happy Meal toys. Make it happen.
Yep. I want to go to, like, a Walmart and just find them, like, crawling all over the shelves and everything. And let's just face it, they're going to be plushies soon.
Yes.
Bruce cosplayed as Stay Puft one time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did he make it as a balloon? Yeah. Like, he was a balloon Stay Puft Marshmallow Man?
What else would Bruce have made it out of, Annette? Come on.
I don't know.
Annette, just you're supposed checking. To be the sensible one. What the Yes, no ordinary balloon man didn't make a Stay Puft Marshmallow out of balloons. He took a bunch of cabbages and just taped them together and spray painted it white. And no, really, the cosplay was... he originally wanted me to make a video of that cosplay, but it ended up not looking good. It really wasn't in his best. It was, like, close to the side of my back. I think it's because one of his like, stilts broke at the time or something like that. Yep.
Yeah.
Anyway, so... sorry, I had to chug that down. So, yeah, that's coming out here, We got what I think is Slimer in the trailer. I don't know whether that was Slimer though.
Yeah, from what I looked over, and I have it on just to look over some stuff as well too. Just from the way it kind of seems, it kind of, I guess, like, the afterlife is not like in the outside world. It's kind of like in the second movie where they had that river of slime under New York City. I feel like this is, like, almost a similar thing where there's, like, something underground or something like that, it seems.
Yeah, it's like, okay, I just want to say up front. I want to say this up front. I didn't really like Ghostbusters 2. I thought it was really boring.
Yeah.
If you like it, more power to you, whatever. I'm not gonna splash you, but I just couldn't really follow it too well. I mean, like, it seemed, like, a little bit too different.
That's the one with, like, the guy coming out of the painting, right?
Yeah, Vigo.
Ego.
Yeah.
Oh, Vigo, yeah.
Yeah, Vigo.
My name is Vigo.
That was weird.
Oh, yeah, look, Vigo just wants his puppy.
I do like, how in the video game, Vigo's just at the Ghostbusters station. Like, I'm talking about the one that was re-released, that's technically a sequel to the second one.
Like, yeah.
When I saw that, I'm like, why the fuck is Vigo's painting in the Ghostbusters headquarters?
Yeah.
I never got that.
That would be weird. I honestly don't understand when people will, you know, keep a possessed object. Like, the people who, like the Annabelle people who keep her and all like that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Great power to them, but I don't know. I would not keep that in my house or anywhere near me if I knew the exact thing. Like, oh yeah, this
is a cursed object.
Exactly.
This cute little thing, very adorable, known for killing three families all at once in one night. It's gotta stay at my house.
Yeah.
I'm gonna put it right here, right on the refrigerator.
Right there for everybody to see.
Yeah.
I think Aqua Teen.
Maybe they made sure that it wasn't possessed anymore.
Like,
No. It fully is. Like, they have it over in whoever owns it. Like, it's supposed to be a Raggedy Ann doll.
No, I'm saying about the Ghostbusters thing.
Oh.
We're gonna bring
maybe they made sure that the painting was no longer possessed.
I got an idea. Let's bring in a caller here. Let's bring in a caller.
Yeah.
Let's bring in Kenny Arkenpony.
Yeah.
Direct from Arkham Asylum there. Kenny Arkenpony, you are on Ants! We're talking about Ghostbusters. Kenny Arkenpony.
Oh yeah, this is lemonade, by the way.
Why is it in a keg?
Oh, that's like a big water bottle. Yeah, oh, that is a big bottle.
It's one of those big water bottles that just like kind of gives you little inspiration things.
That's
like,
so true.
Good morning. Hydrate yourself. Remember your goal. Keep chugging. Feeling awesome. Don't give up. Almost
Kenny,
finished. Did it.
Kenny. I don't think Kenny has much to say. All right. Let's try someone else. Let's try JJ the Jet Plane. JJ, you're on. JJ, you're on Ants. You're on Ants. We're talking about Ghostbusters.
Yay.
Hey, guys. Hey, guys.
Hey, we're talking about that new Ghostbusters trailer.
Oh, yes. Yes. And those
marshmallows. I love them. They're so cute. I want to make one.
Me, too. I never even have marshmallows, but I
love how Paul Rudd's also in this, too.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, like he's so good.
Why not? The last one. The last
you
one.
Mean the kid. The. Okay, you go first. Sorry.
I was gonna say like the last movie. The last Ghostbusters movie had Thor in it, so now we got Ant-Man. There you go.
Yeah, and
yeah,
I know. Finn Wolfhard or whatever his name is.
Oh, Stranger Things.
Stranger Thing.
Oh yeah.
Stranger Things.
Yeah, I think that's his name. Oh, Wolfhard.
Yeah, Finn Wolfhard.
Yeah. Yeah, he's good. He's a good actor.
Mm-hmm.
And was the secretary from the original Ghostbusters movie the one who was saying all that?
Wasn't she the one who was like selling them the house or the
exactly,
one?
Exactly. That's what I was curious about.
Yeah. But yeah, we got Dan Aykroyd having a cameo in there, so we know he's in there.
Yeah.
I remember in an interview, didn't Bill Murray said he would not be in another he would not be in a Ghostbusters movie unless he plays as a ghost or something?
I don't know.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know if he was in the other one, but, you know.
No, he wasn't. He was in the
Yeah,
he
Bill Murray
the
was
one.
In the 2016 one. Yeah.
Was he a ghost, though?
No.
No, he died, though.
Yeah.
Yikes.
Wow.
I'm trying to remember the context.
I do love that in the trailer, though, that they do show where, like, them watching their old ad for them.
Mm-hmm.
I thought that was pretty interesting, just because, like, you see that it's on an old YouTube page.
Yeah, I know. I know. I tried looking it up, but it's not an official video. It was supposed to be Ghostbusters Sad 1994. But, here's the thing, okay? Like, the villain is kind of obvious. It's going to be Gozer again.
Yeah, that's what it looks like.
Wait, from the 2016 one or the, old one?
Gozer wasn't in the 2016 one, was he? She?
No, no, I don't think so.
What is Gozer's gender? I gotta look that one up.
God? Demon? Whichever? I don't know.
Mm.
I feel like if it comes to any biblical or any kind of like mythical creatures,
and Slimer
I feel like whatever their gender
the
is, it's what they
as well.
Gozer is genderless, though it appears as a female in the movie. Oh yeah, because in the movie, one of them says, let's take this bitch back home. Or something like that.
Yep.
Yeah.
I will say, like, from the second one, I honestly did kind of just like the whole Statue of Liberty coming to life for a second.
It was weird.
It was funny.
It's in control by the NES Advance.
Oh, yeah, that was awesome.
JJ, tell me, who's your favorite Ghostbuster?
I'm gonna say Boo Murray.
I'm gonna go with that as well. Okay. Although, close second would be Dan Aykroyd.
Why does no one like Harold Ramis? He's one of the reasons why these movies exist.
I was gonna say my favorite is the guy from Honey, I Shrunk the Kids.
Yeah, Rick Moranis.
Rick Moranis.
He's not a Ghostbuster, but he was great.
Yes, he is. He had the suit and everything on.
Oh, my God.
I forgot that part.
We saw him suit up, have the gear. He's a Ghostbuster.
He went on the bus with Slimer.
I did not see that as well.
Was he the Keymaster or the Gatekeeper?
Keymaster.
Yeah.
I am the Keymaster. Are you the Gatekeeper?
Yeah, I remember the innuendos.
Yeah, that's so weird. Yeah, that's kind of cool. And they turn into devil dogs as well. That's kind of weird.
Definitely. Go in there. There is no what's her face, only Zool.
Mm-hmm. What about the eggs exploding by themselves?
Like,
I will say it does kind of almost seem like it is drawing similarities from the second movie. Just because it does seem like where you're having like some sort of ghost pit or something like that, where ghosts are just like coming out and like and, like going into the city, like how in the second one all the undead started like having their jobs and everything, like the taxi driver who's just like,
okay, so I'm just gonna also JJ, thank you for joining us. I'm glad to talk to you.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks, guys.
Yeah.
See ya.
Okay. See ya.
I'm gonna say that Slimer is always on cameos on every Ghostbusters movie. I hope he will be there in the afterlife. All I see is the blue version of him.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
That would be interesting.
That would be cool.
Okay, so here's the thing. We got, Finn Wolfhard, Paul Rudd, Bill Murray will be back as Venkman, Dan Aykroyd will be back as Raymond, Ernie Hudson's back as Winston, Sigourney Weaver's back.
Nice.
Okay, I'm actually impressed that they got her back.
He appeared, and yes, Harold Ramis will only be appearing in clips and photos.
Aww.
Okay, before I cry, let's talk about the next thing there. Shang-Chi? Shang-Chi? Shang-Chi.
Looks like... I feel like you're doing this on purpose.
No, I'm not. I'm really not. I'm actually considering that because the trailer says Shang-Chi. And it says Shang-Chi. I don't know.
It's an A or...?
It's S-A...
It's with an A.
S-H-A-N-G. Okay, I'm just going to look this up. We're going to look it up before we discuss this further. In the meantime, when we do it again, we're going to try Kenny Arcimpone again while I look it up. Kenny Arcimpone, you're on Ants. I'm looking it up. You talk to them.
Yo, what is up, Kenny?
Hello. Yeah, it doesn't seem that his microphone is working.
I gotta buy time somehow.
Can you hear? All right, can you hear?
Okay.
Can you hear my voice talking through? Talking through to you. Can you hear my voice? But yeah, while Evan continues to look that on, I still will talk about Ghostbusters a bit. A little bit on, not Harold Ramis, about Winston was in Kevin Smith's show, Comic Book Men. He comes on the show to participate in a. One of the guys had the idea of renting out a ice cream truck, and not giving out ice creams, but giving out comics.
Yeah, that is actually a cool business model.
No, okay.
Comic books.
Yeah, listen, you're a little kid. Imagine little Annette, right?
Uh-huh.
You hear the sounds of the ice cream truck coming over. You grab your mom and be like, "Mom,
it's not a comic book. It's not the ice cream truck. It's a comic book."
Exactly. So imagine you're a little kid right there being like, "Yes, I want ice cream," and they're like, "We don't got ice cream, little kid. We got comics and a Ghostbuster."
Well, okay. Here's what I got. A lot of people have called it Shang-Chi. Marvel Studios president Kevin Feige and star Simu Liu, they were offered their pronunciations, but even those don't seem to have settled the question of how to properly say it. Marvel comic readers have long pronounced it as Shang-Chi, as Shang-Chi. Feige tends to pronounce it as Shang-Chi. Points for trying, but that's not it. How does Asian-Canadian actor Simu Liu pronounce it, though? He actually, according to this article here, a comic book reader, or CBR.com, I think that's what it's called. I don't know.
All right.
So let's take the thing from the star. He actually provides his own handy guide for speakers struggling to find the correct way to do it. In a tweet, Liu wrote out, as Shang-Chi, as it's close as one can get in writing. But let's try and get it even closer. So, yeah, Shang-Chi.
Okay. Shang-Chi.
Hey, everybody thought the planet Zebes from Metroid was called Zeebs, so, you know.
Yeah.
I didn't kill Kenny. He just won't show up. I can't kill what doesn't show up. Okay, Shang-Chi. So, Shang-Chi in the Ten Rings. We were talking about this earlier. I wasn't on here. So I do want to point out here that there was also a featurette that was released on the movie that revealed some behind the scenes stuff, and the stuff they're going to fit the whole atmosphere with that whole like Chinese Japanese Lebanese look at these, I don't know, but like
I will mostly say it's probably more Chinese due to all
I just looked it up. He's known as the master of kung fu. That's China, so.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So yeah, I thought the seven. I think the Ten Rings weren't they the wasn't that the organization that captured Stark?
Okay. So what it is on the Ten Rings? That is just their names, kind of. Like that's kind of what it was supposed to go to in the MCU. Like that's what their version of it was. It was supposed to be, I guess, some sort of group, but it's mostly supposed to be the Ten Rings that the leader has specifically is what they were.
Hmm.
That's why they had the name, because the leader, Shang's dad, like, he has like these 10 mystical rings that give him power. And they kind of changed it in the MCU. They, instead of rings, they're giving him like bracelets or something like that.
Right. Those,
yeah.
Well, still, those rings, well, technically they're rings shaped. I mean, like, they're technically rings.
Yeah, the rings shaped. They're like the rings in the way that Sonic gathers rings.
Yeah. It's a theory that says that those rings are actually, because in the comics, he gets those rings from a alien dragon, I think it was? Or
we did
like
see,
some
well,
sort of...
We did see a dragon in the trailer.
Yeah, we see like several mystical beasts. They like a dog.
There was like there was one that was underwater. That was a dragon's head. But like, I do like the rings. They look. I like how he uses them, like the tools, like the whip and the swords and everything. That's really cool.
Yeah. Oh, speaking of which, last night, me and my boyfriend decided to watch Iron Man 2. He still hasn't seen most of the MCU. He saw Iron Man, the first one, and I decided, okay, let's see the second one. And so it's been 10 years since I've seen it, and it was. Just so such a trip, because I had forgotten most of what happened in that movie.
Iron Man.
Forgot that Black Widow was like had her debut in that movie.
Yeah, Iron Man.
Oh, you forgot that?
Iron Man 2. People either like or hate. Hey, Cruiser, how you doing?
Hey,
hello, Cruiser.
What's up, guys?
We were just talking about Shang. We were talking about Shang-Chi.
Yeah.
Listen tight.
Anyway.
I've been re-listening to the freaking song from the trailer of Shang-Chi. Like, just like how it just opens up, just like that nice beat.
Oh, yeah, that was cool.
Yeah.
I like that stadium, by the way. By the way, where is his shirt? I want to know where his shirt went. But, I still like how they got, like, a kung fu, like, atmosphere to it. Marvel hasn't really captured, has done a lot of stuff there, but I like the idea of doing like a kung fu movie. It's really cool how they can like.
I mean, they do really good fight choreography.
Yeah.
One thing that I actually was seeing a bit on Reddit was like people hoping that they're not gonna like, you know, how they do like whitewashing on actors that kind of thing. And it's just like, it was like, I'm pretty sure there might be some, but I don't think it's gonna be like maybe the main cast.
The only character they really whitewashed was Tilda Swinton, and everybody loved her in the end.
Yeah,
but it was still just the whole thing of like people bitching about it. Like,
well, they got.
I mean, Tilda Swinton is talented, but that could have gone to an Asian actor.
Well, they did with Black Panther. They got a good African American African cast.
Yes,
cast of black actors. Absolutely. So,
who's my baby?
Yeah, I saw that cute picture of that.
Hey, cat. Anyone?
I saw that picture of Axel sleeping on you. It was adorable.
Mm-hmm.
He's really taking a shine to you. Is it a boy or girl? Excuse me.
It's a boy. Mm. Most ginger cats are male.
Really?
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, it's very rare when you find one that's female.
Wow, that must be worth a lot.
And
I'll be right back. I'm going to go check out my food.
But for some reason, whenever Axel here has to take a piss, he does it right in the shower drain.
Not in the litter box?
Not in the litter box. I have no idea why. I'm like, well, I mean, he's doing it in the right spot, I suppose.
Yeah, flush it out, you know. Just make sure. Hopefully that won't damage the drain. I don't know, but all right. So I guess while he's here, let's talk about the next subject here. Yeah. Honestly, I couldn't decide whether I should include talking about this. However, considering how much of an influence it had on pop culture with its memes, quote, and legacy, I think it deserves a spot. I'm just going to say it up front. I still use that quote that DW uses on that show. That sign doesn't scare me because I can't read. That quote is going to be...
Arthur.
That quote is forever... That quote is forever hilarious. You will never convince me it's not.
Because I can't read.
Yeah, that's
okay. That's a good one.
Who could? But yeah, like let's talk about this because you know it's got a good underground fan base. So after a 25-year season-long run, Arthur is finally coming to an end. This is believe it or not, this is actually huge. This is the second longest animated series in like airing on TV right now. The number one obviously being.
SpongeBob.
So in a way, this is aside that legacy that Arthur had being the second longest animated series, this is like almost the equivalent of Nickelodeon openly announcing the cancellation of SpongeBob.
Right.
So the final season is set to end in winter of 2022. The developer Kathy Wei, WAUGH, I can't really pronounce it, was on the was actually on an Arthur fan cast called the Finding DW podcast with Jason Swimmer?
No.
SZWIMWEER.
Swimmer?
Zwimmer. Jason, where she stated, Arthur is no longer in production. We had our wrap party 2 years ago. I think PBS made a mistake, and I think Arthur should come back. And I know I'm not alone in thinking that they made a mistake. I don't know if it was a ratings issue or it felt like it needed to be retired. To me, it felt evergreen, like it was never going to end, but it did end. We finished the last episode, season 25, 2 years ago. While I'm not taking sides, apparently that state, like, I think we all can agree no show can go on forever. Like,
I mean, depends. Because how many episodes are in these soap operas, the daytime soap operas?
Right.
That varies.
What about Sesame Street?
What about the evening news?
Yeah.
I never thought about that.
I think that, well, I mean, like, how long has the Tonight Show been around?
Pretty long, actually.
Well, the thing but that's different a bit. They have a variety
It is late night, so it's a different genre, we'll say.
Right.
So, but
and different hosts as well too.
But
five.
But yeah,
it's only five.
But yeah, apparently. I'm not taking sides on whether or not it should go on or not. Her statement actually isn't false. Apparently, a good majority of the actors are still confused at this decision. The voice actress Jessica Cardos, who's the voice of Sue Ellen, tweeted, "We, the cast, are heartbroken." Some of the other things here, I actually posted in the Ants chat here. The voice actor for Binky actually tweeted out, 24 years is a good run for a gig, and this is the face I made at the very last season. Binky, though, seems not nonplussed. He's always been tougher than me, and I was just starting to get the hang of the whole dad thing. He plays Arthur's dad. Thanks, right, Arthur. It's been a great ride, and I say hey. And that's the thing, because the show actually did gain an underground fan base, not just with the memes, just a lot of people grew up with it, myself included. One of the big one of the biggest known fans out there is actually a guy, Peanut Butter Gamer, who of Normal Boots, who's a YouTuber, who actually did tweet out his response there. Everybody was like messaging him, and he tweeted out there, "I love his response." Arthur, sad emoji. Arthur is going to die. Sad face.
Oh my god.
So yeah, but yeah, I think I wouldn't make a big deal about this, but one of the biggest questions I think everybody is asking is why?
I think the better question is why not? I mean,
like, here's the thing, canceling a show is one thing, but what is the reasoning around it?
I want to just put this out there.
Yeah.
What if they're gonna do like that whole thing where they do with one shows where they're gonna age Arthur up.
Yeah.
All grown up.
There's actually an AOK video series on YouTube. I recommend Arthur as a grown up. It's fucking hilarious. It's like three episodes. It could be the show had a long run.
Sure. Lord knows it did.
Sure, there was that 2019 scandal with Arthur's teacher having a gay wedding. However, considering how other shows are incorporating LGBT characters into it to create the new norm, that can't be the sole reason.
But I don't think it needed that.
Yeah, well,
I'm sorry. I just don't think that should be in kids' media.
Yeah, well, Sesame Street covered heavier topics such as autism, adoption, divorce, LGBT, love, death, racism, 9/11, homelessness, and much, much more. That counts to pass.
I don't think Muppet that had cancer, didn't they?
I'm not sure. I don't think a kid needs that.
Why? Like, kids get cancer.
I mean,
too.
Anybody can experience stuff like that.
That's why they made it, just so kids could feel comfortable having
cancer. How about you let them be kids? Whatever happened to that?
Well, what does that mean?
Kids have a lot of questions on stuff.
Do you really need to fear them with real world stuff?
You want to at least have them, let them be human. You don't want to sugarcoat it to everybody. My mom even told me that she says the world's not is a good place, but there are some things there. You gotta know what goes on and how to act more human.
It's like, anyway, you cover them differently than you would an adult. You like tone it to a kid's perspective.
So anyway, there was the executive producer, Karen Greenwald, did say that the show will continue to be available on PBS Kids for years to come, just with no new episodes. So congratulations, Arthur. You're now the Aqua Teen Hunger Force of PBS.
Imagine if they cancel for a while, but then comes back and everybody's happy.
They are talking about
which episode?
They are talking about web content and stuff like that. I will say they did actually post a funny meme thing here that said the internet realizing Arthur has been on PBS Kids for 25 years and will be there for many more years. Hashtag stay tuned. It shows all these characters like looking at their computers like stunned. And I like this image because all the computers that are like from the early 2000s.
Oh yeah, the box.
Yeah.
Except for Muffy, who has like the laptop.
Oh yeah, rich kid.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Do they have tablets and smartphones?
Yeah, smartphones have made a thing though. That's like a weird thing with kids shows or any animated shows.
Especially shows that have lasted a couple of decades. It's like these kids are like 10 or 8 or like for 20 years.
Like you look at like shows like even in adults, like long running adult cartoon shows. Like, isn't it weird like seeing them suddenly have like smartphones in that world or something?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about, Cruiser?
Sugars are a little low, so excuse me.
Oh, yeah, take your time, man. Take your time.
Which episode from Arthur do y'all kind of have a better memory of? There's a...
Well, there have been some I've seen more than once, and I remember one I saw more than once was the Mr. Rogers episode.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
That was awesome.
Fred Rogers was on the show.
Yeah. was a voice rabbit, actor.
Yeah,
I think so.
Wasn't he like related to Buster, I think? Or
no, I think he was a friend of one of Arthur's parents, and so he kind of wanted to keep it a secret that like his folks were friends with Mr. Rogers. And like all sorts of, but everybody loves Mr. Rogers, so it's like, yeah, your parents are friends. You're just like, oh man, you're so lucky.
One episode that stuck out to me was when they have the baby.
Yeah,
baby. How like both episodes are intertwined from Arthur's point of view and the other one's DW's point of view of having a new sister. It also it also has my favorite line ever uttered from Buster. Arthur burped the baby right when it was about to explode. It's my favorite Buster line.
The one episode that stands out to me was I think it's probably the one from the images of them on the computer, where they're playing a game where the goal is that they have to pick like six different eggs and each egg has a different personality.
Oh yeah, I know you're talking about that one. I like that one. Wait, was that Arthur the Wrecker where he accidentally breaks the computer?
I think. Because it was supposed to be like once your character died, because you're supposed to take care of them, and once they die, they're just like gone, and it's just going like that. I think that was supposed to be a thing.
Oh, it's like a Neopets guy. It was like a Neopets.
I think that's the whole gist of it. Yeah.
Cruiser, did you grow up? Did you grow up watching Arthur? Thank you.
What timing that was?
Was that no? Is that going to be your official answer, or is that just leave us in wonder? Or what?
Well, I burped myself before I exploded. Thank you very much. I'm a big boy now. I don't watch Arthur.
Actually, Cruiser, there's actually an episode where they do a South Park parody.
You told me about that.
It's really fun.
Seriously?
I saw a few episodes, but I was already past it by the time it started airing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The episode where Arthur and Francine get stuck in the library.
Ooh, I love that episode. They find the lounge.
I think that's one of the early
she
episodes.
Finds the lounge and they just eat all the food in the lounge. Just chill out. They just chill there.
And I remember like thinking to myself, I want to get trapped in the library.
Learning is having fun isn't hard when you got a library card.
Yeah. Yep.
I went to a con and there was a guy selling a giant Arthur library card, and it said on the back, "Having fun isn't hard." So fun. All right, so let's talk about the next thing going on here. It was announced this week that Jodie Whittaker and Chris Chibnall, again, I apologize if I'm pronouncing these names wrong, would be leaving the series Doctor Who in 2022. Oh yeah, again, as usual, a message from my dad: I liked Doctor Who before it was cool. That's from my father, ladies and gentlemen. I prefer the doctor with a scarf like him. Whittaker was the 13th and first female doctor, debuting in 2007, which is technically not true. I'll get to that in a little later. Chris Drebbel was the series showrunner, debuting in 2016 as its executive producer. Hold on, I'm actually going to bring in a caller, if that's okay. Sorry for this, is a quick shift change.
Mm-hmm.
Royal Silver, if that's okay with you guys.
Yeah.
Royal Silver, you're on the ants.
Hello.
Why do people call in? They never seem to get their mic right.
Hello?
There we go!
Hello, Silver.
Hey, guys.
Hiyo, Silver.
How's everybody doing?
Doing all right tonight.
Fantastic.
That's good.
Another Sunday.
Yeah.
But... Yeah, and by the way, happy first day of August.
You
made it.
And a happy Spider-Man Day to you, too.
Hey.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, it's Spider-Man Day.
Well, by the way, just yesterday I got really awesome packages in the mail.
What did you get?
Yeah, I was seeing about that.
Tell us everybody what you got.
I ordered a figure weapon of the Star Saber for my Transformers Prime from the War of Cybertron series.
Oh, I thought you were going to say. I was about to ask. Did you get all the minicons connections or anything like that?
That Trust me, I don't do the minicon collection stuff, so yeah, but also I got a really actually I'm just wondering, are you some of you guys Power Ranger fans?
Was
Ranger fan? I have seen a bit of Power Rangers.
Well, who here has ever watched Power Rangers Wild Force?
Nope.
Mm-mm. Not me.
Well, actually, here, I'll show you guys a picture of what I got yesterday.
How are you going to show it to us?
Probably put it in the ants chat.
You can't access the ants chat.
Oh, you can't. You posted it in the general chat, right?
Yeah,
those pictures.
Oh, yep.
Yeah, like I said, I can't really access the general chat. I can't really go to the general chat during the stream.
Yeah,
I see. Sorry about that.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, I got myself some handmade animal crystals of the Power Rangers Isis Megazord with Falcon, Giraffe, Deer, Rhino, and Armadillo.
Nice.
Yeah. I posted it in the ants chat there.
Oh, you did? Okay, let me just see if I can bring it up real quick. I guess I can go to that. I really don't want to go to too much ants chat there. Let me just go to my face cam here. Here, so that I can just bring it up there. So, yeah, he did post the...
Those are made of crystals?
Actually, that's made of hardened risen.
Oh, risen.
He has risen.
Very cool.
And, technically, the set of those crystals is $250.
Yikes. Whoa. Well, we now know who's buying Cruiser's next convention ticket.
I can tell you where you can find the person that made those. The owner is called ATMP and Props, and the person has a Facebook page for that.
Oh, nice! They do custom commissions.
Yep, this the person creates anything that's Power Ranger related, from weapons to accessories and even to cosplay items such as helmets and suits.
Very cool. That's cool.
Anyway, Royal Silver, thank you for joining us tonight.
Yeah. No
problem, guys.
Enjoy your stuff.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Hey guys, look at this out. Cherry on a cherry Pepsi.
Cherry on a Pepsi.
You ever noticed that cherries look like little hearts? Anyway, so where was I? What was I talking about? Oh, yeah.
You were talking about Jodie Whittaker.
Season 13 will be the last hurrah as this year as a six-part event serial after halting production due to the world being on fire. Whittaker did make a statement, which I'm going to be reading here. In 2017, I opened my glorious box of size 13 shoes. I could not have guessed the brilliant adventures, worlds, and wonders I was to see them. In them, my heart was so full of love for the show, for the whole team who make it, for the fans who watch it, and for what it has brought to my life. And I cannot thank Chris enough for entrusting me with this incredible stories. What's with here's the thing, like, I don't watch Doctor Who. Cruiser, you're a former fan. Like, doesn't each doctor like have a certain like gimmick with their clothing?
I think Jodie Whittaker, she had like suspenders, like maybe like a little rainbow stripe across her shirt.
I don't know. I
wonder if the size 13 shoes is just because she's the 13th doctor.
Mm-hmm. I don't know, but a lot of people did not like that season of Doctor Who, not because of Jodie. They really did not like the writing.
I heard Jodie got some decent, got mild reception. I mean, like, I don't.
Yeah,
the performances were good, but the material she was given might not have been so great.
Yeah, basically, like people kind of summed up her interpretation as a doctor is just the female David Tennant, who's the big fan favorite. And to be fair, it is a good impression. She does express that same kind of fanboy-like wonder and charm, but they wanted something a bit more than just a female version of that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But like,
if the direction of writing might have been different, could have had something great.
So they... Go on. You're the Whovian. Go ahead.
Well, I just want to say that the first Doctor, at least since the when it kind of, you know, came back on TV, like, I think back in 05.
Yeah. Chris Eccleston.
Yeah, he's coming to Orlando.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah. Yeah, and our colleague Raul already bought a photo op with the guy.
Cool. You met you just like it's too bad you couldn't be there because you got a picture with him and David Tennant, right?
Yeah, I got my parents got me the photo op as a Christmas present, and he said he wanted in and went, tell you what, if you pay for your spot in the photo, I'll let you be in it. And which was $50 because the photo was $100. And this is very common in conventions where everyone kind of pays for their share of the photo. Lord knows, Evan and I did that for Stan Lee.
So there's no really knowing when season series 13 will airing. I do know that they are going to be including the infamous Weeping Angels.
Ooh.
Yeah, I just hope that we won't see them actually move this time, because when they came back for Dave Smith's time as the Doctor, we actually saw them move. And while I do get the excitement of that, it did kind of kill it a little bit, because the idea is that they move whenever you blink. Right. Now, that was part of the fascination with them.
They were like jump cut, right?
Yeah.
Something like that, yeah. And the first time we saw them, like that was such an amazing episode. Like, really clever writing, really good work on the time. I guess you could call it time travel. And the effect that they had on there was just fantastic.
Now, there is no news on who's going to be the next Doctor. Nothing has been announced yet, but there actually is a fan theory that's been circling around of who's going to be chosen. In
You're not British.
I don't have to be.
Yeah, I would like, hell, not even all the members of Monty Python. One was American. I'd like to see an American Doctor. Right.
Terry Gilliam, he was the animator.
Anyway, here's why, the fan theory. There's a comic relief episode that appeared for Red Nose Day in 1999. It was called The Curse of the Fatal Death. It was, like I said, it was a comic relief episode for charity.
Right. Yeah.
And it starred Rowan Atkinson, Richard E. Grant, Jim Broadbent, Hugh Grant, and Joanna Lumley. And it was written by Stephen Moffat. Now, Joanna Lumley, and in this episode, Joanna Lumley played the Doctor, not just... She played something as she was casted as the fugitive Doctor, but she was technically still the Doctor, like she was still a Time Lord as the Doctor. So she was technically the first female, not only the first female Doctor, but the first Black person to play the Doctor. So the special does leave it unclear where it fits in the timeline, but a lot of fans have speculated she may return in Whitaker's place, or at least a character that looks similar to hers. If you want to see the episode, I haven't seen it all the way, but what I saw was kind of funny. You can watch it on YouTube page. Just look up Doctor Who, The Curse of the
Fate. I remember about that, the Rowan Atkinson, that was hilarious.
Yeah.
What year was that?
1999.
Oh, wow.
You know what would actually be pretty funny? What? Instead of an adult Doctor, what if we got like a teenage or a kid Doctor?
No, yeah. Power Rangers tried that. I would not.
Yeah, no.
No, Doogie Howser.
Yeah, Doogie Howser, but not. Yeah. But the Doctor Who was like it's kind of like a superhero.
Doctor Hooser?
Well, to be fair, Cruiser in the first Doctor's like an aged old man, and then he kind of actually doesn't the Doctor thinking of it now, when the Doctor regenerates, haven't you know, does he technically kind of get younger and younger?
In the one with Peter Capaldi when he meets like the first Doctor, he's literally looking at him and go like, am I having a midlife crisis?
I love that, like the 12th Doctor meeting the first Doctor.
And that was really.
So before we move on to next, here's a little trivia for you. Mm-hmm. When did Doctor Who premiere?
Ooh. I think sometime in the early 60s. I know.
Which Doctor?
No, the original. I'm talking about the first Doctor. The original.
I know.
I think like maybe November 1963.
Okay, don't look it up there, Cruiser. When did it premiere?
My birthday.
I'm sorry?
Yeah, no. You weren't born in the 60s. Okay,
so here's what it did. Doctor Who premiered on Saturday, November 23rd at 1963.
I knew it. It was the day after the assassination of Kennedy.
Thank you. That's how you remember the date.
I do. Wow.
Yep, it was later than scheduled because of the. They actually had to reschedule it because of the assassination.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Technically, it wasn't on the same. Actually, no, it wasn't. It wasn't on the same day. It was the day after.
Yeah, yeah. Anyway. Because I remember because of the Stephen King book 11/22/63, which is a story in which a time traveler goes back to try to prevent the assassination of Kennedy.
I don't get the feeling that's the reason why so many conspiracy theories were made about that. Anyway, Emma, for now, let's just think about this. Cruiser, you want to do Hooked on Harmonic? We still got like three more news things to talk about.
Yeah.
Well. This week's Hooked on Harmonics is going to be more of a memorial.
Yeah,
it's perfectly understandable, man. You want to start it up?
Yeah.
Okay. We'll be right back, ladies and gentlemen, as we go into Hooked on Harmonics.
Hey everyone, Cruiser here, and normally Hooked on Harmonics is saved for just music I've recently released, but sadly this is going to be more of a memorial. This year we lost two legends in rock. We lost Dusty Hill from ZZ Top, and we lost undoubtedly an icon in heavy metal, Joey Jordison. From Slipknot. I had the pleasure of seeing both these bands multiple times, or at least Slipknot. ZZ Top I got to see once when I was living in Buffalo, and they were so well known for that bluesy rock style, those long ass beards, and oddly enough, the one person who didn't have a beard in that band, his name was Frank Beard. Funny. and I don't know what the cause of death is, but the guy was in his 70s. He was definitely getting up there in age. But I was lucky enough to see the guy. And then came Slipknot. My God, there was no mistaking that band. It's not often you see a band with 9 band members in it, all wearing masks and jumpsuits. And that guy was a monster behind that kit. Matter of fact, if you saw my latest episode of Hoof Rock, then you saw that clip with Joey Jordison on the drums doing that fantastic solo of his. Even Evan noticed, you know, why is he wearing, how come he's sitting in some sort of a gamer chair? And then suddenly you see the drum kit not only rise up, but also tilt forward and start spinning in 360.
Yeah, I did notice he was like, he was also strapped down on the chair, wasn't he?
He was. And I had the pleasure of meeting the guy back in 2010 without the mask and the makeup and the jumpsuit. The guy's got a big ass kit, and yet he's like maybe 5'6". I mean, I was taller than that guy, and I got to see him play with my favorite bands, Korn and Rob Zombie. That was just an amazing sight to see. He sounded so good with them. And then he was eventually fired from Slipknot due to his drug problem. Now, some people have speculated that that's probably how he died, but there was also, he also had some sort of a neurological disorder that could have been a bigger factor, because I think at the time it was sober, and the dude was only 47 years old, and he died peacefully in his sleep. So rather than trying to show some new music I got for everyone, I want you to take this time and go back and listen to their back catalog. These bands, they deserve your respect, and just mourn them. And matter of fact, before I end this, I'd like to end with a moment of silence for them. Rest in peace, guys. This is the Concert Cruiser for Hooked on Harmonics.
So, My Little Pony, a new generation of the show coming to Netflix, and Equestria Daily actually posted news of the recent show of the show's premiere dates for countries around the world, which they didn't do on the webpage. So I had to look it up. The air date for My Little Pony: The Next Generation is September 24th, 2021. Plot details. The logline was, the pony world of Equestria has lost its magic, and Earth ponies, unicorns, and pegasi are living in fear and mistrust against each other. Sunny, excuse me, an idea. Sorry, I just ricked there for a second. An idealistic Earth pony and Izzy, a curious unicorn that must embark on an epic adventure. It will take them to faraway lands to make new friends out of old enemies, all while proving that the magic can be brought to Equestria again, and little ponies can make a big difference. Big in all caps. The synopsis is, friendship and harmony have been replaced by fear, and ponies now live separated by species. Sunny, a feisty and idealistic young Earth pony, is convinced that there's still hope for this divided world filled with paranoia. I have a feeling this is going to be very relatable. And, well, however, when she befriends a lost unicorn named Izzy, who wanders innocently into Earth Pony Town of... I do not like this pun. Maritime Bay. The town reacts in outrage. Izzy and Sunny run away together and embark on an epic adventure that will take them to faraway lands and force them to challenge the status quo by facing their fears and making new friends out of old enemies. The world Sunny has dreamed of her entire life could finally become reality as Sunny and her newfound friends fight to prove that even little ponies can make a big difference. They really had to do this twice.
Cruiser's off.
I think the feeling Cruiser didn't like the plot.
Eh.
Thanks to Elias for the heads up. Where do you go?
I don't know. Maybe his internet's out. Wait.
I messaged him to see what happened there. So, yeah.
So the main character is going to be an Earth Pony first.
Cool. Yeah. I'm pretty interested in the characters and the designs and... so far, just from looks alone, I'm liking Izzy a lot.
Hold the topic, guys.
Okay.
I want to see what Cruiser wants to do.
You messaging him?
Yeah. He said he froze. He's just going to try rebooting.
Okay, I figured something technical like that.
So, yeah, I kind of think this one seems a little bit... I'm not gonna choose any judgment on it. I kind of feel like this is gonna be a little too preachy to like a modern day thing there with everything going on there. I mean, like, when did Ponyville become suddenly segregated? It's like, what?
Well, it's not Ponyville per se. It's Maritime Bay.
Oh my god! Like,
it's a different community, probably. Mm-hmm. Like,
a whole
and who knows
new
how long
world.
after the events of Generation 4. That
oh,
this
yeah,
happens.
That's a thing. I didn't even think of that.
It could be hundreds or thousands of years ago. It's like, as long as Luna's been in the moon in Celestia's time, it could be like how long since Princess Twilight.
Well, they are in the series apparently. Let's bring in a pony fan in here. Derpy is the best pony.
Yeah. Yeah.
Derps, you're on ants. We are just having beautiful luck with guests tonight.
Yeah. We really need to, like, see if they're ready before we actually bring them on.
Hey, that's not my fault. They're the ones that know how to they come down there and the...
Well, you...
All right, well, no, he is communing with us. He has Wi-Fi problems.
I was going to say, you mostly just bring them in beforehand. I was going to say, we could just have someone, like, talk to them first and see who wants to come in.
Well, they can't really tell. Yeah. It's hard to tell. He is communicating me on the chat. He is having Wi-Fi problems.
Well, I mean, me and Annette sometimes look at the chat thing.
Yeah, the screen chat room.
Yeah.
Well, there's like a lag, so you know, I could always do it on Discord. But anyway, so let's move on to the next thing here, just to get these out of the way. A few years ago, we got the unexpected masterpiece that was Detective Pikachu, a movie based on a shitty game where Deadpool is Pikachu and they solve a mystery. I haven't seen it yet due to my busy schedule. So where does it go from there? I'm asking you too.
Where does it go from there? I don't know.
Just tell us.
Netflix announced a live-action Pokemon series is now in the works. Great, let's chalk that up to their upcoming live-action Legend of Zelda series coming out.
Yay.
I'm such a dick.
I can't wait.
Lucifer, for showrunner, the showrunner of Lucifer, Joe Henderson, is attached to write the series and act as its executive producer. Aside that, nothing has been reported of it, but let's take a moment to think of this idea. You see a lot of why is it whenever I look away, people are just leaving?
I'm still here.
I know you are. I was looking up at you, not Fluttershy, so, you know. Now, here's what is going on here. You think of a Pokemon series. I don't know, like, I think the Pokemon looked a little creepy in the movie.
Yeah. Some of them were really well integrated. Others, it's like, were a little uncanny, but for the most part, pretty well done.
Who's your favorite Pokemon on Annette?
Lickitung and Mr. Mime from that movie can go to hell.
Yeah, Mr. Mime was pretty uncanny.
I thought you were answering her question.
that was me speaking out her thoughts.
Yeah.
Mr. Mime, I swear. Oh god, just creepy as hell.
Lickitung's a creepy Pokemon in general.
I mean, from the movie, this the way they had Mr. Mime's face and just how he's supposed to be a human-esque Pokemon, whatever.
Yeah, the humanoid.
I don't want to go into that logic.
It's creepy as hell.
Yeah. The cute Pokemon, like any of the small ones, like Aipom, that was really cute.
Aipom's like small.
Yeah, they're smaller than like other really big ones. I mean, Charizard was really cool. Yeah, Psyduck was awesome. Bulbasaur. Butterfree.
Actually, no, I mostly will say I loved most of all the scenes with the Psyduck, just because.
Yeah.
Who wants to keep a Pokemon that can eventually just I'm sucking, but one that suffers headaches and can, like, you know, whip out massive like psi waves or whatever?
Yeah,
like,
because Psyduck's an OP Pokemon back then. He was actually a very strong Pokemon.
No, I know, but I meant like in general, like say we had Pokemon.
Why would you want to keep something that can cause that much damage?
Exactly. Constantly. He's in constant headaches. That's what the Pokedex says. A Pokemon that's in constant headaches, and whenever he gets to a certain point, he does lash out, or it does, like explode. Yeah. Knowing this, who wants to keep that? Like, that's like almost having a high-maintenance dog, in a sense. Like, the ones where you gotta, like, clean their ears, like,
imagine. I can imagine Psyduck's always like, please evolve me, just please evolve me quickly, I want it gone. No amount of Tylenol is gonna save Psyduck now.
Looking at every water stone, I will steal those.
you're just eating them like Fruity Pebbles kind of thing. Okay. So, here's...
There you are.
Yeah, okay. Hopefully that works.
Let's try Derpy again. Derpy, you're on ants again. Get one more chance. Something's happening. He's not speaking. I can only do it twice, man. I think he's still having Wi-Fi problems.
Yeah.
Oh, well.
Can't be helped.
Anyway, going back to Pokemon here, here's something that's really cool. Okay, this is I actually thought really cool. Pokemon Snap announced some DLC this week. And here's what we got. 20 new Pokemon. 3 new courses, including the Mighty Wide River, Barren Badlands, and a secret side path that involves the Neo 1 vehicle you're driving to shrink. So you can see, like, smaller Pokemon ginormous-sized.
Wow. Now,
first of all, this DLC, it looks good, and it's available August 3rd, and it's for free. A rare moment from Nintendo, ladies and gentlemen. I'm just going to say that. But here's why I find this interesting. Like, shrinking your vehicle to take pictures of Pokemon, of bug Pokemon, at great height. I think that, you guys, can you guys agree with me that's kind of a good original idea?
I'd say. I mean,
I kind of like it.
Cruiser?
Meh.
Well, here's why this is significant. When Pokemon Snap, when the Wii U came out here, Nintendo was asking, what kind of games do you want to see for this? And a new Pokemon Snap was like one of the top three answers. But whenever it was brought up with Nintendo executives, they always said the same thing. Photography was what was really exclusive back then. Nowadays, everyone has a camera. So if we were to make this again, we'd have to find some idea to make that's original and fresh. And lo and behold, they found something original and made it fresh.
Yeah.
So yeah, they really put a lot of thought in this game. I'm really interesting.
Not only is it like taking pictures, but it's like taking them from a different perspective.
It's a Pokemon first person shooter. it basically is.
Actually, speaking of things about like photos or things like that. Cruiser, you remember that one game I showed you about that like very. Oh, wait, no, I don't think it was you. It was that one, I think it was you. It was that one where I was talking about where it's like stop motion and all like that.
Oh.
I'm really thinking I might get that game because I've been looking more at it. It's pretty cool.
There's a game that is like stop motion animation?
Basically, what the creator of it did was that he did like the way that he made the puppets and everything for the characters, but the way that he kind of made them with animated and all like that is that he would put them in position and have them hanging from something or suspended to where he would take photos of it, but he would have like this light source that would go around them so that wherever the light source was, you would see that shadow and so in the game he doesn't have to like design and do all that programming. It's just the images of those characters changing from scene to scene kind of thing.
Is pretty cool.
Epic.
Anyway, our last piece of news tonight, I just want to show this thing out here because Disney's next series is going to be Hawkeye. And they dropped some info on Hawkeye's show. We got a teaser image of Jeremy Renner, I think it is. I keep thinking it's
Renner or Reiner, I think, something like that.
Yeah, I think it's Jeremy Renner.
Renner, Reiner, or Reiner. Jeremy.
Yeah.
Jeremy. And Haley Seinfeld.
Not Seinfeld? Or
unless I spelled it wrong, I'm just saying there. Let's take a look at the tweet here. There's the tweet. Wait, that's not it. What the fuck? Oh, yeah, here's the tweet. Here's the tweet right here. It's on the Discord here. For those who want to see it here in that shit.
Yeah, Haley Steinfeld. Yep.
Haley Steinfeld. What did I say? Oh yeah, I put down Seinfeld. I must have autocorrected. I'm together here. And look at those lights in the background. You see those lights in the background there?
It's Christmas.
Yeah, I'm gonna say this might be the first Christmas Marvel film since Iron Man 3,
or at least one that's centered around it.
Yeah, well, I mean, technically Iron Man 3 did kind of center around Christmas. Tony Stark saves Christmas.
Hey.
But yeah, it's going to be premiering on November 24th after since Loki's done. So yeah, I'm looking forward to that. Finally getting some good news. Hawkeye is one of my favorite characters there.
From what I want to assume from this maybe is that he could possibly maybe train his daughter to take on the mantle of Hawkeye while he takes on the mantle of Ronin maybe. Like from... It's a whole thing from the Marvel What If comic thing as well.
Yeah.
That they were tying in with the whole Endgame Endgame and all like that.
So there was actually there actually is one thing about Hawkeye that Jeremy didn't like that they included about him. The original Hawkeye is deaf.
Mm-hmm.
That was one interesting change they made about him. You know. So that's for our news tonight. So Cruiser.
Well, no, he's not like deaf by choice. Like someone comes and like stabs arrows.
I meant by original design.
I know. That's what I mean. Like, no, he's not deaf. Like already, like someone came up and stabbed arrows into his ears. That's why he's deaf.
He wasn't born. Okay, that's fine.
No, he wasn't born deaf. No.
Oh, I thought I keep forgetting that. All right, Cruiser. No. Let's talk about our big. I showed the trailer earlier. before the stream. I liked it very much. So let's talk about our what we're excited for next week.
Yes, the very first Jason Voorhees from Friday the 13th, Ari Lehman, is going to be on Ants. A horror icon is going to be on our stream. yes, that little boy who popped out of the water and scared the shit out of the world.
So, I got a question for you. How old was he in that when that movie came out?
To be honest, I'm not entirely sure.
I'll look it up.
The one question he keeps getting asked is, wasn't it cold? And he keeps saying, no, I wasn't cold, okay? I grew up in Chicago, okay? Where it's always cold.
Wow.
But I can tell you that for the longest time, he didn't do another movie. He actually wanted to focus more on his music career.
He does music?
Yeah, and oddly, he went off into the world of, like, African tribal music.
Oh. Not a guess.
He was only 14 in that movie.
Whoa!
You made me, you sounded like Wayne from Wayne's World right then.
Whoa! Yeah, he did. And he was just doing, you know, his thing. And until suddenly a friend of his contacted him and showed him this signed picture of his. And he goes, did you sign this? And he goes, I never signed an autograph in my life. And his friend goes, someone sold this to me for $50. And Ari could not believe it. He didn't realize there was a demand for him on the convention circuit.
Wow.
And that's when he decided to go check out a few conventions. And he had a large number of people who wanted to meet the first Jason Voorhees. And because of his musical background, he decided to create a band to basically cater to this crowd called, appropriately enough, First Jason.
Dude, I can't. Like,
what a concept.
Yeah, go on. Keep telling more about this guy.
Yeah, and he played. Now, he is a classical and jazz trained pianist. That's where his background is. But he knows that's not this kind of crowd. So he invented a machete keytar, like a giant cosplay keytar that he like duct taped this like a tiny keyboard to, and he shreds like he's Jimi Hendrix on this thing.
Dude, what is it with your music friends and duct tape? What is this weird comparison? Look at this guy.
It's just like the Force in Star Wars.
He looks like a fusion between Geezer Butler, Weird Al Yankovic, and the badass from Day of the Dead.
He does kind like of like Weird Al, but with a cool mustache.
Be in mind, I say that in all respect.
Yeah.
What do you
despite you know, playing, you know, one of the original slashers, the guy is oddly enough, he's a vegetarian.
Really? Nice. I can talk to him about that.
Yeah.
But yeah, he
and Kuma, I'm sure you and him would get along too.
He actually. Yeah. Yeah.
Why is that?
Because I'm vegetarian.
I'll let you figure that one out. I'll let you figure that one out, Kuma.
Oh, he's a pilot too. Cool.
He did a lot.
Yeah.
He did do a lot of short films though. His last one was in 2019.
When this started happening and there was this demand for him, he also decided to get back into filmmaking. However, he's taken the more independent route.
It's fine.
He prefers that, as a lot of people do, because no one wants to deal with Hollywood. And like, he actually was in this movie called Clown Motel. Horror film.
Oh, God, no.
No.
That movie was so stupid, I swear. God.
It must have been a bad one, because apparently it's not listed in his filmography on Wikipedia.
Mm.
Oh, my God. I want to say it was kind of like...
I mean,
first time I saw it, I just thought it was just kind of stupid. I mean, it made me laugh a bit. It was like clouds, really? For a hotel.
Oh, my God. Cruiser. Sorry, you go on. Yes. I got No, go on. Just talk. There's actually some of the things he has on here is actually pretty coincidental and funny.
Well, it has a 70. The Clown Motel has a 77 on Rotten Tomatoes.
Okay.
I'm just looking at his filmography and
so
like,
there's
Friday, Die Day?
Yeah, I was about to say all these. Most of these, like four of these movies, are like themed after a holiday: Friday the 13th, Thank Xgiving, Pi Day, Die Day, Easter Sunday.
Yeah.
Kind of funny because he's Jewish.
Yeah.
He's Jewish also?
Wow. I can relate a lot to him.
Well, I think he is. He told me that he basically celebrates everything. Cool. So yeah. I'm going to put Hanukkah in there.
Yeah.
It's like you give him every single greeting.
And I'm sure he has a wealth of stories to share. Like I'll give you guys one. As a lot of people may know, Kevin Bacon was actually in the first Friday the 13th movie.
Yep.
Yeah, I remember about that. He was so young.
Mm-hmm. He was a better Tonto than Johnny Depp. Sorry.
Yeah.
And at first, there was not going to be that huge scene at the end of the movie with Ari. So Ari's, you know, main shots were just, you know, him kind of, you know, just drifting in the water. However, when they decided to do this final shot, this final scare, Ari was excited. So he's in the makeup chair. Tom Savini's like putting all this stuff on him, and then Kevin Bacon walks into the room. He goes, "Hey, Ari, what are you doing?" And Ari, in the most thespian way possible, goes, "I'm getting into character."
Nice.
And Kevin Bacon starts laughing.
Dude, I cannot wait to ask about what it was like getting his makeup done by Savini. I love that guy's work. We got another. Mm-hmm. We got one final caller here. I'm gonna bring one more. Prince Goldfish, Golden Prince. Yeah. He's a prince. Prince. Okay, Prince. What's up, Goldfish? I'm gonna take a guess what he's probably gonna be wearing.
Hello.
Oh. Prince. He's muted. This cannot be a serious, weird coincidence.
Yeah.
Like every single person we brought in here has been having audio issues, and this is literally a first. I don't know why.
Yeah, I mean we had JJ come on
and Silver and Hi-Ho Silver.
Yeah, that's true. We had him on a second time, and he. It actually worked.
Yeah, well.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I like what Derpy wrote here in the chat. Hashtag Discord hates bronies. And that, ladies and gentlemen, so now Cruiser's statement of this never happens on Skype is now justified. There you go.
Yeah, this never happens on Skype.
Okay, so, Cruiser, first Friday the 13th, what is your favorite line?
Favorite line?
And you cannot... And the sound of Jason brushing his teeth does not count.
I'm going to have to go with the classic. You're all doomed. That, or maybe... Killer, mommy. Killer.
Oh, my God. To think that I'm that, what's her face? Betsy Palmer. Actually, when she saw this script, she said it was a piece of shit.
Wow.
Yeah. The sole reason she did is because her car broke down. She needed money for a new vehicle.
She was really? Just stranded there and needed a money.
That was it. That was it. That was the sole reason why she did it.
There's a footage of her on a game show. I think I forgot what it was, where her bra comes undone, done under her dress. It wasn't a wardrobe malfunction. It was just like my bra just. She's like laughing. Like she's like, my bra just came in after under my dress, and everybody's laughing. Yeah, Betsy Palmer.
Apparently, according to IMDb, Ari only spent 4 days on the set of Friday the 13th.
I don't blame him.
Imagine, 4 days.
He was only in the movie for like freaking how long? Like 30 seconds.
Yeah.
Yeah, that
part of his audition was like, can you swim?
That's pretty much it, yeah. He worked with the director, Sean Cunningham, on another movie.
Yeah.
So that's how... Yeah, it was like some sort of like high school soccer thing.
Yeah, it was called I was actually gonna bring that up to you. It was called I'm looking it up here. Manny's Orphans.
Interesting.
And yes, when you look at a movie with a poster that looks like this, I think you're in for a surprise. I just also want to point out this is the poster's resolution. Look at this thing. It's a square. This is its actual cruiser. This is the poster's actual size. This is it. That should be a running gag here. The moment we introduce him, saying we got Ari Lehman from Manny's Orphans. How are you doing tonight?
Yeah.
We just don't even acknowledge Friday the 13th the entire night. We just talk about Manny's Orphans. And whenever he brings it up, he's like, we like either just change the subject or like what the fuck is a Jason?
I don't know if he's played either of the Friday the 13th video games. I do know that someone actually showed him that they did in fact put his Jason in the most recent game, which he was very flattered by, because, you know, when you're an actor, they don't tell you anything. You're like literally the second to last people to know. The last people who get to know is the audience, basically.
Yeah.
Wait, he's the little boy Jason's in the video game?
Yeah, not necessarily as a playable character, but just if you actually manage to unlock everything, you can actually open up this path where you take a boat out into the lake, you're hanging to the cops, and his Jason pops out of the water and grabs you.
That's cool. Oh, that's cool. It doesn't really make any sense because you're being stalked by adult Jason, but I still think it's cool.
Well, like I said, he's not a playable character. It's just a little Easter egg they put in there.
Yeah, otherwise you have characters killing a child.
Although, Cruiser, let's just be real for a moment here. They put NES Jason in that game. Would you even be surprised if Little Boy Jason was an unlockable character you could play as?
Kane Hodder loves NES Jason.
I like him. I like him too. NES Jason is awesome. I mean, in the real game he's from, it's a piece of shit. But you know, like freaking. God.
Have you seen how people could take down Jason in that game? It's kind of funny to me.
I like the game over screen. Cruiser, if you will, what does the game over screen say?
You're dead. Your friends are dead.
No, that's James Rolfe's show. It's just Sybil. You and your friends are dead. So, but I think the video game's winning screen looks freaking hilarious. Jason just you win the game, and there's this image of Jason just. He just looks like he just came back home from work, and it says, you finally managed to defeat Jason. Dot, dot, dot. But is he really dead? We're not telling. We're not telling. And we get this image here of Jason looking like he just got back home from work. Like right here. Oh, wait. Hold on. Let me.
No.
It's so funny. Like, let me see if I can find it real quick. He's like on the ground. He's like, oh. Have you ever played that game, the original one?
No.
Dude, I own it.
But have you played it?
Yes.
Is it as, and it's really as bad as everybody says? Mm. Oh, come on. I don't want emails about your fucking... Okay, here's the image. Here's the image. This is what it says. It's,
found again, it.
This is it. He looks like he just got back home from work and just wants to be left alone.
Yeah, he's just sitting in the corner. Look at we're not telling.
I want this tattooed on the nape of my neck.
It looks kind of like one of those demotivational posters or something.
Dude.
You know what's funny? What's funny is actually I was watching an anime and the characters are at a lake house and somebody's talking about, you know, there's a bear around this lake and we call him Jason. And the main character's like, why is Jason? Jason's a weird, like, and then they're out walking along and they find a bear print and it's like, oh, Jason! And it's like, I know what they're referencing.
Yeah, that would be cool. I'd like to see Friday, like, horror movies like Friday the 13th or like Nightmare on Elm Street given like a single episode anime treatment.
Yeah, that would be really, really cool.
With or without the death scene, because I think even just in the first movie, there are
like someone made this image of
several.
Here's an image of DeviantArt. This it's not really good. It's kind of foggy, but it actually shows hockey mask kid Jason killing the girl in an anime style, like right down there. The image is bad, but that's a cool idea.
Yeah. I would say adapting any of those horror classics as an anime, at least as a scene, just animate a scene from one of these horror movies as anime style. That would be awesome.
Anime style, and do a whole new movie of Freddy versus Jason.
That's how about like an anthology?
Because I wish I had more fight in that, honestly.
Go ahead.
No, go on. You go. You're the horror dude.
Yeah.
Well, there was a Friday the 13th series at one point, but supposedly it had like nothing to do. Yeah, like supposedly it had nothing to do with the actual events at Camp Crystal Lake. Supposedly is like maybe a prequel to it, but I'm not entirely sure. There was even like, I think there was even a Nightmare on Elm Street game. A series at one point.
Yeah, it was like a horror. It was a horror anthology series with Freddy.
Yeah. I would love to see Masterpiece Theater hosted by Freddy Krueger.
he knows the idea.
I do know that also, Jason 2 actually lives right here in Florida. Matter of fact, he lives right down West Palm Beach.
Which one? Ari?
Warrington Gillette. The guy who burst through the window.
Awesome.
Yeah. He's actually trying to see if he can get his own horror film made. But, of course, like any filmmaker knows, that's going to be a rather pain in the ass. But of course, everybody recognizes Kane Hodder as the official Jason. Ari just sees himself as Baby Jason. That's what he called himself.
He's adorable.
Baby Jason.
Baby Jason. Here's the thing there. Like, I was watching the Cinema Snob, right? He was doing the first Friday the 13th, and it goes to the scene where she's trying to hide from Jason's mom, and the corpse just falls out, that the girl that was killed in the shower. And I like Brad's reaction. He was like this. He's like, Betsy Palmer did that. Come on. But like here's a good idea for a series on Friday the 13th. Cruiser, hear me out on this one. We've seen a lot of stuff on Friday the 13th. Why isn't there a series that basically shows what happened to Jason at Crystal Lake? I mean, we know what happens, but why haven't we had a show that just shows what happened?
Right, like from like Jason's perspective, or from like one of the teenagers' perspective.
From the first day he goes to Crystal Lake. I know he's there because his mom works there. I think it was.
I thought she lived there in general.
I just think she just wants to send her boy to camp, try to make some friends.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like but imagine.
Did she have a house, a cabin there?
I think she did in the comic series.
There was a comic series on Friday the 13th.
Oh, there's a lot of stuff about Friday the 13th. There's video games, comics. But yeah, imagine that. Just like we show the first day of Jason at camp. Like, I don't care if it's like three episodes. We show what his life was like, the torture he went through, and everything up to his death.
I mean, what's interesting is that one of the series of American Horror Story, the one called 1984, that deals with a camp on the lake kind of setup. And so one of the slasher killer that's in that show, they go into his backstory, and he grew up at this camp. He was bullied, just all sorts of things. His brother died on the lake, and the teenagers didn't stop it, blah, blah, blah. So it's very tragic, and it really made me think of the Friday the 13th film.
Like, we've seen Freddy's death in two movies. We've seen Michael Myers or life as a kid in... Was it just the shitty Rod Zombie movies? But what about Jason? I would like to see a series about the exact torture he went through. I want to, like, what created this killer? or how it works. Yeah. How did his mom find out about this? Like, what? It's like crazy.
And what's interesting is this month we have a Friday the 13th. Did you realize? It's a Sunday.
What?
This month we have a Friday the 13th.
Yeah, next week.
The first day of Everfree Northwest is Friday the 13th.
Hey, that's a good point. The day we're, I mean, technically it counts. We're beginning the week of that with that Friday the 13th with him in it.
Right. That's like next Sunday or.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Next Sunday.
Okay, I wonder how Ari, like, what happens when it's Friday the 13th? What does he do? Anything special, or it's just another day?
Pulls out his favorite knife, you know.
It's funny because
he gets out the fine cutlery.
It's funny.
Appreciate these sharp objects.
He admires the arm he dragged the girl down with.
Oh,
here's like,
they go out for a cruise, you know, on the lake.
I would totally like to go on a cruise on the Crystal Lake, which apparently, why not? It apparently leads to New York City, so there you go.
Well, I know he and Adrian King, who survived the movie, they've actually done meetups at the actual camp.
Really?
For fans and signings. Where is this actual
camp? Is there a Camp Crystal Lake, or is?
I don't know if there's a Camp Crystal Lake, but there is. But it was filmed at an actual camp.
A little bit as heads up here.
I mean, there has to be ones that have that name, but aren't the actual.
If you want to see a good review of each movie, I recommend either the Cinema Snob or James Rolfe's retrospective on each movie. Mm-hmm. Considering he was also in the documentary and also has his review on the anniversary DVD of the Gideo game, which is pretty cool. But like, here's the thing. Okay, Cruiser, which Jason is your favorite? I mean, I think I already know the answer, but go ahead.
We're talking strictly design.
I'm sorry, what was the question?
Are we talking strictly based on design?
Yeah, because he has a different design in each movie. Like, which Jason do you think would be your favorite? Hard to choose, huh?
I'm going to say Freddy versus Jason. Jason.
There you go. I like him too. Remember that time we were talking and we were actually you were telling me about the different Jasons that were in the game, right? And I asked you,
yeah.
And I asked you, dude, does it have Freddy versus Jason? Jason, he's like, what's the difference? And he's like, he has the claw marks on his mask, and you're like, oh my god! You're like, oh my god! I didn't even realize that.
I'd say a close second, though, would probably have to be maybe Kane's first iteration, because there was it's kind of hard to see, but there is actually detail within the costume. Like, you could actually see, like his backbone, maybe some of his ribs.
Mm. Oh, yeah, is that the one where he's electrocuted there? You can kind of see some of the organs in there.
Oh, boy.
Mm-hmm.
God. Like, friggin'... Yeah, I liked him when they did that one movie, Friday the 13th, Jason Rides the Fucking Boat. There's a scene where he's chasing them at Times Square, right? And there are these punks that are just gathered around a boombox just chilling out, right? So Jason's chasing them, but he's walking as usual, and he just kicks it out of the way, and the guys pull out these knives. He's like, "Yo, you got a problem?" What does he do? He literally just looks at him, turns inside the camera, lifts his mask, and the guy's like, dude, it's cool. It's cool. Just bam. But what's cool is when he was filming that, Kane, everybody in Times Square was cheering him on, and he just stayed in character as he looked at everybody watching him.
Yeah, there's a lot of things that they asked Kane to do as Jason, not even in the movies, that he just didn't understand. He actually appeared on the Arsenio Hall show as Jason.
Cool.
Wow.
And Kane did not understand why. He goes, why? He doesn't do anything. Meaning Jason.
Yeah.
And he's like, that's fine. Just let it be. Well, apparently Arsenio is terrified of the guy.
Oh, no. They just terrified him on live TV.
That would have been my order.
So basically, Arsenio Hall is just like, there's Jason sitting there, and he takes a little budge,
No!
Oh, man.
He just owned every single second there. They're like, I would have just said,
it's all about timing.
That should have been his order. Like, go out there and kill him. Just go out there and kill him. I don't care. Oh my god.
Interesting. Both comedy and horror are all about timing.
Yeah. I mean, the last movie where Jason goes to hell is fucking ridiculous, but you know.
Yeah, because it's the suspense that you love. Like,
yes.
If it was just like a movie where, you know, you just see the guy just like going out, yeah, just like doing mass killings, mm-hmm, like, yeah, that doesn't really get it. Like,
no,
him sneaking up and just like walking to the people.
When
and
is it
then, like,
happen?
just the slow kill, like, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's what gets you.
Because, no lie, I mean, like, I know some of the kills aren't that creative, like,
yeah,
like in the first one, but like the way that they still did them with all the instruments and just items, yeah, he had, just, yeah, all that just seemed out there. I mean, oh, not gonna lie, one of my favorite death scenes would probably be from Jason X, honestly, where he like cryo freezes the like half the guy's, yeah, face, I think.
Mm.
Yeah, that one I was like, oh. No,
that's the one where that's the one where Jason's in space, right?
Yeah, he has like some like metallic mask now.
That's,
yeah,
like,
yeah, he looked like Darkwing Duck.
I was gonna say the Mighty Ducks. I was gonna say for the Mighty Ducks.
That was about, yeah, so Mighty Ducks. That's the thing. Like, that was a movie that's just like, fuck it, he's in space. I like how
yeah,
he kills somebody even as he's frozen. He just falls and just cuts someone's arm off as a frozen thing. But I like, jeez, how he wakes up. It's just two people in the ship. They have sex, and Jason just shoots up, like, saying, hey, what's up?
What?
Yeah, they basically embrace everything in that movie. It's like,
if you could choose which horror character to die from, who would it be?
Mm-hmm. Ooh, that's a good question.
I mean, which horror character do I want to kill me?
That. Yeah, like, yeah, any one of them. Who, or like,
if you had a choice.
Yeah.
Like, if any of these characters are involved, I don't know that we would be given a choice. But
I'm pointing this out there. Not Freddy. I do, yeah, not want to die in my sleep,
Freddy.
just because I don't want that moment of just like, you know, that moment of being at peace, just for you to like fall asleep.
Yeah.
Just to wake up to just being like
dying from,
yeah,
Freddy. Dying from Freddy's night is actually worse, because he likes to play with you. He wants to make,
yeah,
you suffer as long as possible.
Yeah,
and
I would
he'll
hate that.
Have some like weird, creepy one-liner.
It's like, who is that guy? Wait a minute. I was looking up Jason Voorhees, and one of the related searches on the top was baby Jason, and it just shows a picture of Ari's Jason on there. Even Google knows. But like, here's the thing. Second of all, Cruiser, why the hell wasn't Uber Jason in the Friday the 13th game?
I think he was. I just think he was a Kickstarter exclusive.
No, I know the Tom Savini. No, that was Tom Savini's.
I think he's in there.
Is he? Hold on a second there. Uber Jason. Wait, Friday the 13th video game. Uber.
I really have to think about that. I do not want to die like from the slasher.
He's in there, I believe. He looks, they had to change him because before he looked ridiculous, but yeah.
Okay, so who do I want to kill me? Showgirls. There you go.
Showgirls?
They're not a horror, though.
It was a reference to the movie Scream. Like, someone calls up, you know, Jamie Kennedy's character, so what's your favorite horror film? And he goes, Showgirls.
Wow.
If there's anybody I would like to be killed by, there's a question I never thought I was going to answer.
Yeah, no.
Not killed by anyone.
Horror character.
Who do I want to kill me? Oh, my neighbor down the street. They're good.
It's hard to say. Oh my god, I'm trying to think of the one that would give me the best painless death.
Yeah, it's like, I don't want to like go in a bloody way. It's like, that's just like, it creeps me out. I mean, it is very strange to think about.
Because, mm-hmm, yeah, each version or each one has like their own way and unique way of doing things.
I was gonna possibly say the Terminator, but like, he's but that's just even creepier because he's just,
Yeah.
Maybe him because he'd technically be shooting me and would kill me fast.
Yeah.
Depends on where he shot you, though.
Yeah. And
he's a Terminator. What else is he going to... He's going to shoot me in a place that's going to kill me.
Yeah.
Depending on what gun is...
The one that killed... Mm-hmm. Well, he's a Terminator. Like, he would...
Yeah.
The only one he killed slowly... The Terminators killed slowly was Sarah Connor's roommate.
Mm.
You haven't... There's actually a funny story about the Terminator that was interesting. Lance Hendrickson's in the first movie, right? He plays one of the cops. And apparently he's one of the reasons why the movie was made. Because apparently, from what I've heard, when they pitched the idea to the producers, they said it was a horrible idea. No one would get scared by it. So Lance is looking there. He's like, really now? So the next day, the producer that said this was at his desk. Lance kicks open the door dressed as the Terminator and has a gun aimed at him and then sits down on his desk saying, so did that scare you? And he's like, fuck yeah, it did.
Oh, I would love to see that happen now.
Everything from Arnold, man. But like, yeah, Terminator air definitely. I like Terminator 3. I don't know what Carol anybody says. Everything after that is shit, but you know.
Terminator 3, it was at least entertaining. It didn't need to happen, but there were some. It was entertaining.
Also, it also was made when Arnold was actually governor, so he's the first governor to actually have a number one box office hit. Terminator 2 is a good movie. All of us can agree on that.
Oh yeah, yeah. Terminator 2 was awesome. I'm just like going down a list of like famous horror movies and like just getting inspiration. It's like, if anything, I'd probably like Die by Birds, like from Alfred Hitchcock's Birds.
Oh my god. Do you want to know what's terrifying about that movie?
What?
First of all, I like the level of suspense of that movie because there's no soundtrack.
Yeah.
But the best part is,
like, in the final
here's the deal though.
In the final scene though.
No, then in the entire movie, there's no music.
Oh.
That's why I actually use that technique with Snow and Mount Silver when the girl's playing the game. I put no soundtrack there. But I'm to ease the suspense. But the thing that's really weird about that movie is there's no real reason why the birds are attacking, except for the trailer, which kind of hints at why, but it's not really too good.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What's the moral? Birds are dicks.
Yeah. We mistreat them.
I know this is gonna seem odd to change the subject, like related onto this whole death thing, but I also want I wanna say rest in peace to Thea White, the voice of Ariel Bag.
Courage the Cowardly Dog.
Yep.
A wonderful kids horror series.
Oh, the one that'll give you a horror trauma before age six.
Yeah.
Yeah, may she rest in peace.
Yeah. It was just sad.
Nope, especially for a show like that too. I love the hell out of Courage.
I want to see I want to see a live action Courage the Cowardly Dog where Clint Eastwood is Eustace and Muriel is played by Betty White.
I would like to see that, but there are certain characters I don't want to see in
put to real life.
We get it. You're afraid of LaQuack. I get it.
Oh hell no! I'm afraid of that Chihuahua chick.
Yeah.
Chihuahua chick. What are you talking about?
The fortune teller.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, this stupid one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
that one, the is stupid, isn't the Mummy Plague, and
I know what you're gonna say.
I was feeling a bit
the
naughty.
Freddy. Naughty.
Yeah, I don't want to see that guy either.
A bunch of people came together and reanimated that entire episode.
Yeah, that was amazing.
I would say King Ramsay's curse, but I don't know what I would look. But honestly, I think he would look kind of bad in live action. Because the full reason why people remember that was because of the old animation, how horrifying he moved.
Oh, hell yeah.
Yeah.
I also remember that one character who kept making characters eat flan. Flan.
Yeah, flan.
Flan. Flan.
By Fantasy Flan.
That's so weird.
Flan just makes me think of that and the movie with Ben Stiller and Jack Black called Envy. Does anybody remember that one?
Isn't that the one where Jack Black makes like
the vaporize.
Yeah.
It makes poo disappear and people want to know, where does the shit go? We want to know. Where does the poo go?
I like how Cruiser's trying not to laugh at that.
And yeah, it is just crazy. And it Christopher Walken's in there.
Oh, now it's a party. I want to see them make Christopher Walken into a Marvel superhero one day.
Yeah.
Wait, has Samuel L. Jackson and Christopher Walken ever been in a movie together?
Clockwork Orange.
Have they?
Clockwork Orange.
What? No.
No, not Clockwork Orange. Friggin'. Oh, fuck. What was the thing? What was that? Samuel Jackson, Does He Look Like a Bitch? What was that one?
That was Pulp Fiction.
Pulp Fiction. They're both in Pulp Fiction.
Okay. Okay.
Stuck it. A place he could hide on his ass.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, we know Christopher Walken can dance.
He's a really good dancer.
Yes, Fat Boy
Surprisingly.
Slim.
Yeah.
And Fat Boy Slim does not put himself in his music videos.
No.
I think that was a wise choice.
Not at all.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would like to see a movie where it's Christopher Walken and Samuel L. Jackson as the cops.
Yeah.
I want to see how that would turn out. Okay.
Christopher Walken and Samuel Jackson doing what now?
Being buddy cops. Or yeah. something of them being a dynamic duo. Something that makes them a duo.
There you go.
Wow.
I would love
He's
to see.
He's 78 it. Right now.
If there's anything, I would love to see Samuel Jackson and Christopher Walken star in the Final Five. Welcome to the Final Five, ladies and gentlemen. This is where we leave our final thoughts on shit and shit that goes good. So, stuff is looking good and things are looking good. Good and fantastic. Yeah. Things are getting better. This time we're better than ever.
Getting better all the time.
This time we're better than ever. Awaha, awaha, it's time we're better. I don't remember how the rest of the damn song goes. I was about to say, but Cruiser does on the other hand. Cruiser's giving me like this look right now. You can't see, but he's like slimy. All right. So as usual, ladies go first. So we're gonna let Annette go. Annette, your time begins now.
I'm so happy once again to be able to do Ants in a timely fashion, on time rather than in the middle next week. Let me see my schedule. I am working Sunday from 4 to 8, so I'll be late that night, and the week after that as well. So 2 weeks in a row being on time ain't bad. And next month, me and my boyfriend will be moving down to Florida, and that's going to be a whole adventure. So we're planning all that. And hey, if you're watching this show and haven't done so already, please check out my Bright Idea channel on YouTube for, wait for it, Bright Ideas.
Bright, you need to make a new video like soon. I'm not even hesitating.
I know.
All right, next up will be, I want to be a little different today, so I'll go with Cruiser.
Go! All right, Bright go! Bright and I are working on our collab. I'd say the writing is just about done. We're working on the reprisal section. And while I put Bright in charge of puns, there were a couple I came up with that I'm rather proud of.
As you should.
Yeah, and people, if you love puns, this is going
to
be full of them.
I'm afraid to edit this.
I said, Bright, lay everything you got on this one. And I even had to reach out to a friend of ours, Pony Codero, if you're familiar with Bronny Buck's Discord, because I had to figure out what was going on with the music with the reprisal here. But I'm hoping we'll have that done this month, and hopefully before Bright moves. Hopefully we'll have it recorded, and then Evan can start, and I'll be out in Seattle here in 2 weeks. Heading to the war zone. Yeah.
Nice.
Okay, cool. So next up will be Mr. Kuma. Kuma.
Who's still not streaming.
Mr. Kuma, begin. I can't hear him.
Oh, what's up?
I had to adjust.
There you go.
Okay, here, I'll start you over. But,
yeah.
Begin.
Okay. You. And, yeah, I know Cruiser was trying to be funny when, that there's a three rule joke, so it doesn't really work. But yeah, been doing more D&D things, just trying to write some stuff, and I don't know, yeah, I've been making up more stories, just making up things, and seeing which one sticks for whatever campaign I'm running for my group. Like, I'm literally just making the campaign up as they go along. I don't have anything, like, solidly written. Everything is just bits and pieces. I'm just going, oh, this will work. It'll be fun.
Is this homebrew? Totally?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, everything, like, it is basically the base rules of D&D, but everything, the world in my head and everything that I made up, and just how everything is just working in here. Like, there's no...
So it's yourself, you're going on a journey.
Yeah, I just
time
the world and everything else like that, and that's all.
All right, so I guess that leaves me then. Before we go on to your adventure, my time begins. I have been so busy this week, guys. Like, I keep getting things thrown at me. It's like been all over the place. I do have one thing coming up, guys. Like, I am almost done a part of Wurl. I'm working as hard as I can.
Sorry.
I'm working as hard as I can, guys. Like, I really wish I could get some more help on this. But, like, I'm working as hard as I can. With my laptop back, I'm going to be going back into stuff there. But, you know, it's going to be slow still. I'm hoping so. I'm starting to lose confidence in myself a little bit. But I know I can do it. Anyway.
You can do it.
I certainly hope I can. Anyway, so with that said, keep you guys posted. Fuck it. Jule. It's the only thing I'm saying close to it. Okay, Cruiser. I'm sorry. Next up, we're getting you up to Kuma's quote of the week to end us off. We'll be right back.
What is up, everyone? My quote comes from a video game, actually. It's called Wildermyth, and I highly recommend it. I don't remember the full thing of it. I just remember the last parts of this being said. So it goes, memories of the old will one day be dreams of the young. And I actually kind of liked how that sounded, honestly. Memories of the old will one day be dreams for the young. And yeah, pretty sweet. And as always, from all of us here at Ants, good night. And remember, keep your cutie mark clean, and you'll be fantastic.
Julie!
We've had lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of fun, but now the time has come to go. If this still clown was found dead in his bed tomorrow, I'd be in heaven still doing this show. See you some other time! Yeah!